One of the benefits of having a garden is a retreat to escape to. Now, the garden I'm going to show you today is so secluded, the only way to get there is by boat. The homeowner is a garden designer himself, and his passion project, well, it's his own home here in Pittwater, New South Wales, where he's restoring this lovely heritage cottage.
Hey Charlie, how are you?
I'm good, you well?
Good to see you.
What an amazing way to arrive at a garden, hey? And your own private beach.
Yeah, we're quite lucky here. It's beautiful. It's a lovely spot, and it's certainly a morning spot.
Yeah, absolutely. This is great, but this staircase, so dominant. Tell me about this.
Yeah, well, it's the original staircase of the house. It's about 130 years old.
Yeah, the way it's all just rounded off is so... Oh, it's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Well, I cannot wait to see the rest of the garden. Lead the way.
Let's go and have a look.
You get your steps in on this, wouldn't you?
Yeah, you do. Completely.
So, Richard, as you come up the garden, you're enclosed by these incredible gum trees and the whole space feels very serene. It's really lovely. What were you trying to achieve when you started on the garden?
The cues were always going to come from where we were, like from the bush and from the nature, mm-hmm. And so it was set about trying to restore that balance and just once we'd started clearing the weeds, allowing a lot of the seed bank that was in the soil to regrow and regenerate, so almost a hands-off approach.
So you've created destinations at the high point of the garden to help draw people through.
It was hard to move around the space, so putting in stairs. Putting in different areas of interest up the back. So we have a petanque court up here, which is just a nice level spot. We started to find a lot of beautiful buried stone from the old terrace walls that were built 130 years ago, and using those to recreate the stairs and other new pieces of walling that look like they've always been there.
The path we've just come down is obviously original to the cottage, and this is something you've put in?
Yeah, we created this large round circle as much a negative space as a foil to the trees and the canopy around it.
And the view through the trees at the water is something that a lot of people wouldn't normally do. They'd chop down all the trees, wouldn't they?
Yeah, it's often about, you know, when we're seeing clients or when we're working in the city, you know, views are super important to stakeholders. But here it's about celebrating the trees and allowing them to enhance the view, I feel, by framing it. Views are better through trees.
And what trees are they?
Mostly spotted gum. Keringai National Park is mostly made up of a spotted gum community. Uh-huh. They're quite rare trees. The habitats are becoming rarer.
And I can see we've got this enormous man-made tree as well.
Yeah, the windmill's it's quite eccentric, isn't it? And something you'd normally see maybe on a farm.
Yeah.
But it used to collect all the water from the house gutters and to the detention well below it and then pump it up to the water tanks.
Right.
So it's not currently connected, but we've just had the windmill renovated and it's in perfect working order.
Okay.
We just need to connect it back up to the tanks.
And behind the windmill, you've got this incredible bunya pine. Now, maybe not the best tree to plant so close to a house, but you've got to make the most of it. Look at it, it's fantastic.
Yeah, it's a really beautiful heritage tree. It's about the same age as the house.
Yep.
And we also inherited some of these large Canary Island date palms.
Yes.
And they give a nod to that era that the house came from.
In the perfect world, I'd land next to you.
How much did you inherit and how much did you plant yourself?
There was already aloes and agaves, some of those here.
Okay.
And they thrive on neglect. And so I really just concentrated some of those species in this area, mm-hmm. which is a nice contrast to the grasses that are just growing up the bank there too.
Yes. And I'm sure the wallabies wouldn't eat these as well.
Yeah, it's actually one thing that they don't eat.
And I noticed helichrysum as well.
It's really useful in providing a mounding element. So we're not just looking at these dynamic architectural forms.
Yeah, so just to soften those. One of my least favourite things to do in landscaping is pick something up and walk it to the top of a hill to have to use it.
I mean, not
how
much fun.
How often did you have to do that here?
Well, I've tried to avoid bringing large plants in.
Right.
When you're working with native plants, tube stock's the best way to go, really.
Yeah, it'll establish much quicker, won't it?
Yeah.
And get up to a bigger size quicker as well.
That's right, and they end up being more resilient in the long term against drought and other, you know, they're generally tougher.
Yeah.
More resilient.
Well, I have absolutely loved being here today. You know, it's one of those gardens that doesn't shout at you like a city garden might. You know, there's no feature of a massive swimming pool or something like that, but what it has is bags and bags of atmosphere, which I think so many gardens are missing.
Lovely to have you here. Thanks,
Charlie.
Thank you.
Well, I think I can see my boat, so yeah. I will see you
soon. Off the trot. See you.
See ya.